adorable. I would just love to have you for my next door neighbor.
Thank you. Well, I'm a very, very good neighbor because I'm away a lot.
Oh,
but
are
I'd
you?
Be asking you to do things, wouldn't I? Like stopping the milk and things like
that. I wouldn't mind at all. I think you're absolutely terrific.
Where do you live, Gloria?
Well, I live in a little place called Gladysdale.
Gladysdale?
Yes.
Where's that?
It's about 50 miles from Melbourne.
Is it named after a person called Gladys?
It is, as a matter of fact.
Oh, that's a coincidence.
Yes, yeah, a very quiet little place. But, you've really made my day.
Tell me, are the daffodils out there or the jonquils?
Yes, there's a few jonquils out at the moment.
I love it, you know, when the autumn leaves have changed from their beautiful yellow. Other little yellow things pop out, they?
Yes, they do too.
That's an observation of mine and one of the things that's made me such a marvellous person.
I want to say how much I really enjoyed Barry Humphreys. I never used to be really keen on him, but I think he's getting nicer every time I see him.
Oh, I think he grows on one a little, darling.
Yes, and I must agree, I don't like Celeste Paterson.
I don't think he can help himself, though, darling. But I suppose there are some of our politicians a little like him.
Yes, I guess there is too.
Thank you, my darling Gloria, and for your compliments, my little head is starting to swell. You'll have to go off the line.
No, we could never do that.
Goodbye. Thanks for your call, Gloria.
Bye-bye.
26 and a half minutes to 12 o'clock. We'll take another call. Good morning, 3UZ.
Good morning, Bert and Dame Edna.
Good morning.
I would like to know, what do you do on your spare time?
I have so little spare time. I've just taken up a backgammon. I play a little bit of backgammon. Now, that's my only concession to superstardom. I learnt that from David Soul. Have you heard of him?
Yes, I have. From Starsky.
Yes, he taught me backgammon. And we used to play it quite a lot together whenever he was in London. Or we were often met in jet aeroplanes flying across the world. We knew not where.
Mm-hmm.
And other recreations, well, I do a little bit of cycling. I've taken up cycling. I've got a beautiful Cyclops bike. It's an Australian bike, and I drive that.
Oh.
And I've got a basket in the front. I do a little bit of shopping, just like an ordinary person.
I thought you might throw your gladiolis, too.
A practice. Well, I often thought, why don't we introduce gladioli throwing to the next Olympic Games as Australia's... It's an Australian sport. Mm. Did you know it was invented by the Aborigines, Bert?
No, I did not.
Well, they didn't throw gladies, it was goannas they threw. But I've substituted gladies because when I throw them into the audience can catch them and take them home, but I think a lot of goannas every night, I mean, you'd have to... It'd be impossible, wouldn't it?
Has Rob introduced this to his act, the gladioli throwing at all?
I don't know. I'm not sure. I think it's inevitable that he will. Rolf Harris. Mm. Oh, I think it's inevitable that he will introduce a gladioli throwing because it's, well, it's refined, isn't it? And we know what he feels about the other kind of things. I think Rolf approves of me because I've never been occur... And I've got really an English accent.
Yeah, how come?
Well, I've always been a very... even at school, you know... people used to... Have we still got our little one on the phone?
No, she's just... Oh, she's still there.
Hello.
Yeah, lovely.
Still there. I was just wondering, maybe, Dame Edna, you could fill in for Mr. Hamer. I think he'd make a lovely premier.
Well, I'm hoping they're going to ask me, darling, because we haven't got a mayor or a premier at the moment.
No, well...
So I think I've arrived at Melbourne just in time to seize the wheel.
Yes, I think we need a bit of sense of humour back in politics.
That's right, before the ship of state crashes into the rocks.
That's right.
Thank you, darling.
Thank you. Bye.
But when I was at school, people used to actually laugh at me a little bit because I talked posh, they said.
How did this happen?
I don't know, because I'm Australian, my parents are Australian. They still are. And I don't know what it is. I think I used to listen to the wireless a lot, and I heard those beautiful announcers, you know. John Masters, Alwyn Kurtz, you know, people like that.
Great
and the
things.
Radio plays, the Lux we used to listen to.
Lux Radio Theatre.
Yes. John Casaubon I used to listen to. Muriel Steinbeck.
Muriel Steinbeck.
Lyndall Barber.
Douglas Kelly.
Douglas Kelly, Neva Cargill, Stuart Ginn.
Frank Gatcliffe.
Frank Gatcliffe. You know he's a cousin of Barry Humphreys.
I didn't realise that.
Frank Gatcliffe, and he's in London, and he's often in movies. You see his little face popping up?
Wasn't he Bentley the Butler?
He was Bentley the Butler for Brown Gouge.
Do you remember that? I do remember.
Frank Gatcliffe, and, of course, dear John Gatcliffe, who is Barry Humphreys' favourite cousin, is living down at on the Mornington Peninsula at the John Vowell Centre, and a special cheerio to you, John. It was his birthday the other day. So the Gatcliffe family are very, very dear indeed to our hearts.
But you haven't explained the English accent through listening radio.
Well, I can't explain it. Mm. But, you know, Rolf Harris, I suppose, well, What kind of accent do you think he's got?
Well, I think he's got an international accent because obviously wherever he works, the sort of trade that that he presents to people is wholly and truly the real Australia.
Yes, it is the refined Australia, really, isn't it?
The real Australian.
Mind you, we haven't all got beards and three legs.
We'll take another call for Dame Edna Everidge, who's our special guest this morning.
Hello?
Are you there?
Hello? Hello,
Dame Edna speaking.
I think I know that voice.
What can I do for you, darling?
Oh, look, I just had to ring to say how wonderful I think it is that you're back home, and we just love hearing that lovely voice
Dame
of yours on the radio.
It's Patty.
Patty! Hello, darling. Do you often ring up Bert's show?
Beg your pardon?
Do you often ring in at Bert's show?
I do, yes. I often sit home and I just listen to what he has to say, and if I don't like something, I usually ring and tell him, you know, and give him my opinion, and if I do like it, I still ring.
That's a lovely working relationship, Patty, and may I, too, say I wish you all luck in the world with your new program opening on Wednesday.
Oh, well, look, that's lovely of you, Damon, especially coming from you. Thank you. I do appreciate it.
Because a lot of people have said to me, I think Bert and Patty are going to be the new Bob and Dolly. And I said, well, I love Bob and Dolly, but I think these people are extra special and very different, and I think it's going to be a big hit, because you're very dearly loved, and I think your professionalism that you're going to bring to the show will be marvellous. And if I was any of your competitors on any of the other channels, I'd be trembling in my boots. Patty, darling, gorgeous to ring me.
Oh, look, it's lovely to speak to you.
How are the kiddies?
They're fine, thank you.
Lovely. I've got a little poem I've written.
Well, look, thank you for the one for Matthew. I treasure it. I really do.
I've not done quite as well, but I'm going to read you this one.
All right. That'd be lovely. I'd love to hear it.
All right, here we go. By the way, what is Lauren's second name?
Lauren Elise.
I thought so.
Named her after Lauren Bacall, Dame Edna, because Bert always loved the name.
And the little lady, if I may say so.
Yes.
He used to tell me, I can't tell you everything now.
Well, you know too much, Dame.
He saw himself as Bogey, I think.
Oh, dear.
Listen to this little poem, Patty.
Okay.
And this is not just a Patty, not just a bird, but it's to everyone. It's lovely to be back in town, though leaves have turned from gold to brown. But daffodils and jonquils hold their fragrant share of sunlight gold. And there is sunshine past compare in the tresses of a kiddie's hair. A child who reminds me of the sun is dear Bert Newton's youngest one. I like to think that she's my niece. Adorable blonde, Lauren Elise. The rains may tarnish autumn's gold. The daffs may wilt in Melbourne's cold. But the winter cannot mar or hurt the sunshine you bring to Patty and Bert.
Well, isn't that beautiful?
Patty, I know I speak on your behalf. I don't know why, Dame Edna, you're so kind to us, but you always are, and we do appreciate
it. Nothing, something I jotted in the taxi.
Lovely. Thanks for your call, Mac, and I know you'd be thrilled to speak to Dame Edna. Dame Edna, would you just, for Patty's sake and everybody else's sake, I'm not very good with my descriptive powers, just explain exactly what you're wearing this morning, because you look so delightful. You really do look out of this world.
What am I wearing? Well, it's... I suppose it's a slightly, well, you could say butch, if I wasn't so feminine.
Yes,
by the way, isn't this all this chat and this chit-chat about Billie Jean sickening?
Yes, it is, isn't it?
Just because her name is Billie, they start suggesting that she plays hospitals.
Mm.
Oh, makes me sick.
Yeah, terrible, terrible.
Paper talk.
But it's a sign of the times, you see.
And they say it about my bridesmaid, Madge Allsop. They've said rumours about us.
Mm.
Just because she has a full beard.
Mm. Now, of course, also there was a lot of talk, sometime years ago about Kenny.
That was sick talk too. But I mean, I think when you're famous, it happens. But there's one little motto my mother taught me. She should never be insulted by your inferiors. You can't be, can you? Think of that, Bert.
Let me just explain. I'll do my best.
I'll tell you what.
It's in slight. Would that be a mauve, I would suggest?
It's a mauve, but it's in the form of a kind of double breasted suit. It's a tailored suit, viewers or listeners. And it's mauve, and it's got a nice chalk stripe, but it's sort of a lilac colour. Lavender.
Lavender. That's the one. That's the
lavender,
one I was trying to think of.
Lavender. Wool. All Australian wool. And it has a little stripe. So slightly, well, the butch look, which I'm bringing in. Little silk shirt. Beautiful little silk tie. and a little severe, perhaps. Gives me a rather wicked look. But a beautiful, notice this beautiful brooch on my lapel. Yes. Isn't it good?
Now, where I'm sitting, I can't see your footwear. What sort of shoes are you wearing?
I'm wearing my little half-calf-length boots today, because you never know with this weather. And incidentally, because it's treacherous weather, I'd like to pass on to your listeners a couple of very good cold cures, if I may. First of all, if you're getting a cold, or you think you've got one, it's the garlic, Vegemite, and Vicks cure. A teaspoon of Vicks vapor rub, a teaspoon of Vegemite, and a whole big bulb of garlic mashed up. Cream it all together in an old jam tin or bottle. Spread it all over your chest. Stick a brown paper heart, cut out a big heart and brown paper, and stick it on this poultice. And get Band-Aids and stick it all over yourself.
So it adheres to you?
It adheres to you. And all the Vegemite, which is full of vitamin B, sinks into your skin, the garlic burns and works, and the Vicks, of course, and in the morning, if you're not better, well, you'll be dead. And don't worry about the smell. It smells very, very strong. But first of all, if you've got a cold, you won't smell it, will you?
That's common sense,
isn't it?
And secondly,
it's such a strong smell, no one can believe it's coming from you.
That makes sense to me. Look, anyone who wants that recipe, you just have to call us here at 3.
Oh, darling, aren't you patient? Because
yes,
everyone is jamming the switchboard, and I wish I could speak to everyone.
I'm lucky last, apparently. I just want to reiterate the first call. I think you're absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you. What's your name, darling?
Audrey.
Yes. Are you a redhead?
I used to be.
Yes, Audrey's are. Isn't it funny?
I don't know. I'm ex-show business. I used to be a showgirl at the Melbourne Tivoli.
Oh, I bet you've got beautiful legs.
I don't know. Isn't
it a pity the Tivoli burnt down?
Beg your pardon?
Isn't it a pity the Tivoli burnt down?
It broke my heart. I was overseas and I came back to Melbourne. It wasn't there anymore. And the Regent Theatre isn't there anymore, you know.
And you drive past the Tivoli and you see it says Tivoli Arcade,
yes,
and I think, well,
right.
It's not the same.
It's really heartbreaking.
But one of the things that I think is sad, and I was saying it to Bert during one of the commercial breaks, that there's a shortage of comedy, you know. I love to provide. I don't mean to be funny, but people seem to think I'm a bit of a hoot.
Oh, you've got a fantastic talent. I think you're gorgeous.
But there's not enough humour, you see. So when someone does come up with a bit of humour, they get torn to shreds, don't they, very often?
Oh, well, I think the world has lost its sense of humour in many ways.
Well, it's the world, this old sick world of ours needs it more than at any other time.
I agree with you.
And they need your legs back up there on the stage.
What was your surname, Audrey?
Big pardon?
What was your surname when you were a Tivoli ballet girl?
Showgirl, my darling, showgirl.
Oh, big difference, eh? Big difference.
No, not really. I used to be in the ballet sometimes. I used to dance.
What was your surname?
Shaw.
Audrey Shaw.
My first show was Forbidden City.
Forbidden City.
That's in 1946.
Do you think there are a few stage door Johnnies looking a bit wistful as they listen now, Audrey?
I don't know.
They might be. A few who might have looked at you through binoculars from afar.
Oh, some of them did. I'm quite sure they did.
Well, I love to talk to a fellow trooper, Audrey, and how sweet of you to ring me, darling.
Oh, look, I really think you're absolutely terrific, and I like that show. I'm living in happy retirement now. And I listen to Bert's show practically every morning because I love the old show business and I love the gossip from Hollywood. I've got both ears tuned. And I think Bert's got a terrific show, and I hope he has very good success with this one on Wednesday.
I think it's inevitable, but I don't think anything, you know, you've got to work at it, and I think they have been. They've put a lot of planning into it.
I think they'll be fine.
Thank you for your call, Audrey.
Thanks, Audrey.
Okay.
Nice hearing
good
from you.
Thank you.
Thank you. You opened your new show for Melbourne.
Oh, I'm back at Her Majesty's, yes. And may I just make one suggestion to our listeners, because I know there are a lot of people and have already booked. But there are plenty of seats available. The best thing to do is to write. Look in the paper and decide what you want to do and send a stamped addressed envelope to Bass Victoria, 124 Exhibition Street. Don't try tingling on the phone. It's a new computer that does all this now. And in many ways it's wonderfully efficient and it'll give you the very best seats available. But it's much better to write, sending a stamped addressed envelope to Bass Victoria, 124 Exhibition Street, and I'm so longing to meet and share with as many of my fellow Melburnians as possible over the next month or so.
We've had a lot of reaction from the cold cure, Dame Edna. Would you have any others that you could pass
on
this
morning?
Well,
yes, I have. The cold cure, of course, is marvellous, and one of the things I'm doing for my little froggy throat is the pantyhose suck. Now, Dame Edna's pantyhose suck. Are you ready, ladies? Now, this is